Greetings, guys, girls, non-binary pals, and welcome back to another video. I hope that you are well, and I hope that you are fighting, because there is a lot to be fighting for. As usual, there'll be a link in the description to the page on my website with a bunch of petitions, donations, emails to send to MPs, etc., etc. Today's video is going to be a little bit different. Today, we are talking about something that everyone has an opinion on, and a lot of the time, those opinions are quite extreme, one way or the other. And that topic is K-pop. K-pop is either something that you love or you despise. There are a lot of reasons people claim to despise K-pop, and that goes all the way from calling K-pop artists manufactured and fake to just not liking the fan culture around it and absolutely hating the fans, and that then reflecting onto the artists themselves. With fans being called like crazy fangirls and like they're overreacting and just excessive fans and belittling them for those reasons and many more, which is then reflected onto the artist and makes people see it as less of an art form and less valid. Today, I'm going to be talking about these words and these actions, not only from people in their like everyday lives, but also from the media. And we're going to talk about the effects of those things and where they come from and how they are impacted and influenced by things such as misogyny and racism and how it continues to perpetuate that idea. So today, we are talking about the real problem with K-pop. Something that is notable in all parts of society is that things that young women enjoy tend to be completely diminished and dismissed as unworthy. That goes all the way from things like makeup and Starbucks and fashion to things such as music and K-pop. We saw it with Beatlemania, Bieber Fever, Direction Infection, and so on, where people take something that young women enjoy and they twist it and turn it into a joke, something to make fun of and belittle and take away their talent and their hard work and make it into, well, they're just liked because they're pretty boys. They don't really actually have that much talent. Girls just like them because they're pretty. And not only does that diminish them and their art, but it also like gets rid of any sort of opinion that women can have and any sort of real emotion and connection and thought that they have. It's just like, ooh, pretty, I like, which... So by erasing their talents and their work and telling women that their opinions and their hobbies and things that they like aren't worthy, it makes them feel small and it disrespects the artist and what is being enjoyed. And you don't have to like someone's music, you don't have to like someone's art in order to just respect it. You can just leave it. Just leave it alone. You don't have to make women feel inferior for enjoying things just because you don't like it or you don't see the appeal. Men will try to pass it off as women being too emotional and too attached to things, and that we overreact to things and just get too attached. But then they're the same people who will turn around and like riot in the street for enjoying sports, and that's just totally fine and acceptable. They can spend all their time playing video games or going to sports matches, getting dressed up for sports matches, fighting, yelling, etc. And that's seen as totally acceptable and totally normal because that's something that men enjoy. So therefore it's okay. So why, when people really enjoy a specific music artist or art form, is that then completely unokay and stupid and crazy? Partner violence increases when teams lose. Violence in general increases when teams lose. And that's not being over emotional. That's not taking your emotions out in like an unhealthy way or being obsessive and caring too much about something. Why is that totally acceptable? Why is it okay for men to be on the street rioting, causing violence, and being totally immersed into something that they enjoy, but as soon as women get together on Twitter and just like are actively vocal and enjoying something, that's crossing a line. A lot of people who form opinions on K-pop have never actually listened to K-pop. All they've done is see people interact on Twitter or talk about it on Twitter and haven't really looked any further into it, yet they decide to form such strong opinions based off of that. People take it upon themselves to bully people and make a mockery out of people who enjoy K-pop because they've decided that it's something that they don't like and therefore take it upon themselves to make fun of people who do enjoy it. And a lot of the time that includes misogynistic, racist, and homophobic comments. It's seen as emasculine and therefore bad to enjoy K-pop or anything that is largely enjoyed by women, which, for the record, not that it matters, but a large amount of K-pop fans are not young women. In fact, like, a majority of BTS's fandom are adults in, like, the medical field, business field, law, etc. Thus, they partnered with Hyundai to sell an 8-seater car, which sold out quite quickly. The idea that a fan base is exclusively just the people that are very active and vocal on Twitter is quite amusing and very just incorrect. Like, occasionally you'll see interactions on Twitter between, like, someone calling a BTS stan a stupid teenage girl. Like, what do you know? You're just a stupid teenage girl. And they reply, like, I am a 35-year-old doctor. And then the person just deletes their tweet. It's quite amusing to see. Again, there's just this overall culture of people feeling the need to shame people for enjoying things and obsessing over things. And, like, why do you spend your money on these people? They don't know you. Why do you spend your money on them? But I would like to circle back and bring it back to sports, because a lot of these people have no problem with men buying, like, t-shirts that are ridiculously expensive for, like, their favorite sports teams, or, like, doing face paint, buying merchandise for their favorite sports team. You have no problem with that. So why is it automatically an issue if a woman is buying, like, a CD or a t-shirt to support an artist that she likes? A lot of people then go into the fact that they're everywhere. BTS is everywhere. They trend all the time. They reply to people. They exist on the internet. Oh no. But no one is forcing you to interact with that. You can just ignore it. If you want, you can literally go into your Twitter settings and block the word BTS. Like, it's possible to do that. If you really don't want to see it, chances are it's not going to be on your feed because you're not, like, following any topics related to it. You're either actively looking for it, or you can just ignore it, like, block the word. Twitter makes it very easy to do that. Moving on to the next issue, we have racism. There are so many instances of racism when it comes to the K-pop industry, and that comes from both the general public and just everyday people, and also the Western media as well. So let's talk about some of those. Circling back to what I said earlier about the ability to dislike something without insulting it and diminishing it, a lot of people say the reason they don't listen to K-pop is because it's in a foreign language and therefore they can't engage with it. Which, fine, if you don't want to listen to something in a foreign language, that's your decision. But I do beg the question, why? It falls under the term of what I like to call English arrogance, where we kind of expect the world to revolve around us and our language. We kind of expect everything to be translated into English. We expect English to be spoken. A lot of people will, like, travel to foreign countries and expect everyone there to speak English because that's the universal language. And so as English speakers, we aren't really used to having to listen to foreign languages because the world is catered to us. Colonialism. But then we expect everyone to listen to our music. You expect the whole world to listen to American music. So why is it so absurd for them to want you to listen to their music? I feel like a lot of people would be quite upset and even offended if they found out that people around the world didn't listen to English music, because my god, this music is so good, why does no one else listen to it? If we hold the expectation of foreign countries who don't speak English to listen to English music, then why is it so far-fetched for us to listen to foreign music as well. It doesn't sound like a reason, but more like an excuse that is laced with racism. Intentional or not, you should be aware of the connotations that that statement has and the reason that you may have that prejudice in the first place. When it comes to gaining an international audience, radio play can play a very big role in that. However, K-pop artists get very, very little radio play in the US. A lot of people claim that it's because the songs aren't in English, so therefore if the radio plays it, people are gonna hear it and change the channel because they don't want to listen to music in another language, which is a problem we just covered. But even so, that's just not true. If you look at, say, BTS, their success in the US and just worldwide is huge. It's so massive. And radio stations are very, very aware of this. They get calls and texts and tweets constantly recommending to play BTS songs, begging to play BTS songs because people want to listen to it. And they would gain like thousands of listeners because all those people would find out that BTS is being played on the radio and they'll want to go listen to show their support in order to encourage the radio station to play more of their songs. And the radio stations are very, very aware of that fact, yet they choose to still not play that music. They use BTS fans, ARMY, in order to gain clout and attention by leading them on and saying, well, maybe we will play BTS songs if you follow us, if you retweet us, if you share this. And they'll even nominate them for social awards, like vote on Twitter and you'll win like best fandom or best artist based on like your votes, which at the moment there's one happening and I think they're like, what, 25 million votes ahead of second place. So the radio stations are very, very aware of the amount of people they can get listening to their radio show and therefore would bring in much more revenue for them, yet they don't. And they just continue to use them to get clicks on their website and on Twitter. There is, however, one exemption from this, we don't play K-pop on the radio, we won't play BTS, and that is with their song last year, Dynamite, which I am sure you have all heard. And the reason that song is exempt from this is because it is in English. Dynamite was their first English song, and when it was released, it got over 900 spins on over 100 different radio stations on its first day. In contrast, their Korean single, Life Goes On, that was released at the same time, received 6 streams on its first day. Due to the fact that they did play Dynamite, a lot of people claim that the radio stations aren't racist because they are still playing K-pop music. They're still playing songs from the group. And they played Life Goes On. It was only like 6 times, but they still played it. So therefore it's not racist because they're not being racist towards the group. But it's still xenophobic by completely ignoring the fact that they are Korean. Their music is in Korean. And it's completely erasing their culture and who they are and trying to Americanize them and saying, no, you and your music is only valid when it's catered to us. When you speak our language, then maybe we'll accept you, but we won't accept you as a foreigner. And I once again raise the point that you would 100% expect an English song to be played on the radio in Korea. So why do we not play Korean songs on English radio? This barely scratches the surface of the xenophobia and racism that K-pop idols face outside of Korea, with countless other examples being literally everywhere, and it's completely consequence-free. A good place to see all of this happening is on Twitter, where you see it literally just every day. It's everywhere. Whether it be racist tweets themselves or reporting on racist things that happen, something happens almost every day. Some things are just more blatant than others. And this is a really big, really messy topic, so I'm gonna try to break it down into a few pieces. I'm sure you've seen K-pop themed words and events and tags trending on Twitter. It happens every day. There are a lot of K-pop idols, they are very active, there's constantly things happening, so it makes sense that those trend a lot because people care about it, people want to talk about it. However, in these instances, there are always people who take it upon themselves to go into those tags, into those trends, and just start being racist and misogynistic and using slurs, just unprovoked completely. They go in and use slurs and they dehumanize K-pop idols and the people who enjoy their music, and they bully people and diminish people and just attempt to like make everyone feel small as some sort of superiority complex, I guess. But this doesn't just happen with like trending tags. This happens on just the most obscure tweets where people just go and find things that ARMY have tweeted or other K-pop stans have tweeted and just reply to it with just racism and slurs. Why? For what? What do you gain out of seeking out people who are keeping to themselves in their own community and then attacking them? And not just attacking them, but just being racist. This also happens when like networks and radio stations or whomever tweet about BTS being nominated for an award or talking about their song. You will see so many replies just calling them slurs and just ripping into them and just being really racist. And it's so blatant. It's right there. And yet it's just often very much left and no one ever confronts it or talks about it. There was a time where people were replying to tweets about BTS just with this video.
You fans for naming BTS the best boy band on earth. We rob you. Now on with the show. Ching chong, ching chong, ping ling ching.
And everyone just laughs at the people who call them out. People will say, hey, this isn't okay. And then they snap back and call them like a crazy fan when they're literally just calling out racism. I'm yet to see anyone other than a K-pop stan call out this racism. It's like blatantly like on the internet, on like big public accounts that have like a ton of engagement from people who aren't K-pop stans too. And it just doesn't get called out. Everyone just turns a blind eye when the racism is directed towards K-pop idols. It's something that everyone just ignores because it's just not worth the effort. Some recent examples include a German radio host who was upset that BTS covered a Coldplay song. And so because he was so upset about this, he said that they were a virus.
Irgendein Scheißvirus, ja?
Was?
Wogegen es hoffentlich bald ebenfalls eine Impfung gibt.
Which is a terrible thing to be saying in amidst the particularly the current events where Asian people are literally being hate crimed and murdered because of coronavirus and them being blamed for it. And he also said that they should be sent to North Korea because of it. Which is obviously very problematic given the very long history between South Korea and North Korea. We are all aware that these are very not okay things to say. And yet no one said anything other than fans of the group. The radio host himself, when he was called out by a ton of K-pop fans, said that he couldn't be racist because he had a Korean car, which was actually Japanese. And the apology was directed towards fans, not actually towards BTS themselves. So he called them a virus and said they should be sent to North Korea, which is like a death sentence. And instead of apologizing to BTS for being racist towards them and like wishing death on them, he apologized to the fans for upsetting them, which just completely takes away from the fact that he did anything wrong at all. He's like, oh, I'm sorry that I upset you, you small children upset by nothing. Hush, hush. And it happens all the time. Mainstream media or anyone is called out on being racist towards K-pop idols, particularly BTS, because they're the ones usually involved in this. It's always apologies to the fans. It is very, very rare where apologies are actually made to the people who are victims of the racism. Another example is that recently there was a skit in a Chilean show called Mi Barrio, in which they mocked BTS and referred to them all as Kim Jong-un. They joked about how they all looked the same, which is a very common joke that is made that has major racist undertones, as well as just mocking their language and the way that they speak. And once again, the only people who called this out were BTS fans of the group, which is a problem in itself because K-pop fans in general don't generally stand up for racism against other groups. That is a big whole other issue of K-pop stans themselves being racist and not being willing to admit that. We'll talk about that later. And once again, when they finally decide to apologize after all the backlash they receive on social media, they apologize to the fans and not actually to the people who are victims of their racism. Fans aren't the victims in these situations. The fans are standing up for the people that they love and they are calling out racism that is happening. But the racism isn't happening towards the fans. They're not the ones who need the apology. The apology needs to go to the people who are the actual victims of the racism. It needs to go towards not only the group, but just Korean people in general, because they're all just making fun of Korean culture and Korean people as a whole. These are not K-pop issues. And the fact that they keep being played off as K-pop issues and not that big of a deal is a huge problem because, as I said, this isn't just making fun of a K-pop group. It's not making fun of music or whatever. It is making fun of Korean people. It is making fun of them and their culture and belittling them. And it's not an overreaction for people to be calling that out and saying that it's not okay. And it actually needs to be taken seriously because it does continue the cycle of oppression and Asian hate that is increasing ridiculously. It is such a big problem and it just keeps getting overlooked and brushed off as oh, it's a K-pop issue, but it's not. Both of these events happened just within weeks of one another and they are just a couple of events out of the many that happen. Another example is Void's diss track featuring Keemstar. This had so many awful components to it. And again, no one said anything. Everyone just called out fans for overreacting and making it into a big deal and that it was just a joke, so we need to let it go. And I understand that the song is sort of made as like a way to rile people up and it's like a troll or whatever and not meant to be taken seriously, but those are problematic and they do need to be taken seriously because it is such a big deal and it is belittling people and it is being racist and contributing to the issue itself. So let's go over what was said in this song. Straight off the bat, he is deliberately misnaming people and pretending that he can't tell them all apart. All Asian people look the same, which is a really old, tired, racist joke that continues to be made constantly. And then he goes into their lyrics are basic. They're all like meaningless. And I just think this is very funny because he's obviously never read the lyrics to like any K-pop song, particularly like a BTS song, whom is like the main focal point of this diss track. So I'm gonna read some lyrics here for a second because we're just gonna look at some really meaningless basic lyrics, okay? In BTS's Life Goes On, their biggest song of 2020 after Dynamite, we have streets erased of footprints, I lie here fallen to the ground, time goes by on its own without a single apology. Or their song Waylon 52. My mother said the sea is blue. She said to let out your voice as far as you can. But what to do? It's so dark and there are only different whales speaking entirely different words. We can look at Stray Kids' song Voices. Smash it all, the source that locked me in the darkness and harassed me. I try to get out, but there's no way out until I find the exit. Pretending it's for me, the voices disregard my dream. We're gonna keep going. There's also a Teaser's song, Celebrate. I've colored in my emotions, hundreds and 5,000 of them. I believe that I'm worth it. Another artist you can look at is IU with her song, My Sea. There will be days in which I'll lose against life. Even if I get lost again, I know my way back. And finally, I'll share some lyrics from Twice's Don't Give Up. Take some crayons and draw on your heart's canvas. Don't doubt yourself. Don't hesitate anymore. I could go on forever. There is so much beautiful lyricism that happens from these groups and so many others that is so rare in Western music. A majority of the groups I listed here, their music all follows similar lyrical ideas than those of the examples I've just given you, with the same sort of poeticness and emotion and storyline, and are also written by them, with Stray Kids, BTS, and ATEEZ also producing their own music. Which again, we will talk about shortly. For the next section of this track, I will have to put a trigger warning for December 18th and suicide. So please skip to this timestamp if you need to. Here he shows a tweet with a photo of Jonghyun, a beloved idol who spent many years trying to promote self-love and raise awareness for mental health, who sadly committed suicide on December 18th in 2017. This tweet is talking about how he will always be remembered and how loved he is. And they put an image of a gun threatening to kill fans for being crazy. People were sharing a photo of someone that they love and look up to, whom they miss and were trying to remember. And he told them they should die. He threatened to kill them because of that. And yet the fans are the crazy ones who overreact. He also later in the video showed a photo of his funeral and used it as a weapon of, I wonder why they're all committing suicide. Which is not only extremely insensitive to him and his death, it's neglecting the fact that mental health issues exist elsewhere and that industries and management have a large amount of control over artists' lives outside of K-pop. There is just such a large amount of hypocrisy and dehumanization that happens, and I have to bring that up now because it is such a big theme throughout this song and throughout this whole conversation about K-pop. Talking about how they're owned by the industry and they're manufactured and fake and they're controlled and manipulated. And this is a really big overall issue. And it is racially fueled. And you can see this through the hypocrisy and the way that it is talked about outside of K-pop, as well as just the way that it is weaponized and used in this conversation. Another example of a more recent event of racism and overlooking Asian racism is through a performance that happened on a competition show last week called Kingdom. For this competition stage, there was a group composed of members from three different groups where they had to come together and write and perform a rap. This group, who called themselves Mayfly for this event, decided to use this opportunity to create a rap about equality and diversity and how we are all a different color and together we are just beautiful. Everyone coming together can make such a wonderful painting and a piece of art, but we're all different and our own unique individuals. And this was done through the depiction of paints and rainbows and confetti and just color everywhere. And it included lyrics such as, there is no bad color in the world. All the colors of the world, all united, we ignite, and we bleed the same color. This can be viewed as a song about racism, but it can also be viewed as something about homophobia or any form of oppression, really. It's all about uniting, no matter who you are, what you look like, where you're from, anything like that. It's about coming together and that we are all equal and that is important. However, there was some backlash, particularly from Americans who claimed that they had no right to speak on racism. They took the song and decided to make it fit to what they think is racism, which is racism towards Black Americans. And therefore they said that they didn't have a place to speak about that, which was entirely discrediting the fact that these five men are Asian. They are of color. Once they step out of Korea, they are in the minority. They exist in the Western industry. Their music is enjoyed by people all around the world. And once they step out of Korea, they experience racism. They are treated as people of color. They are people of color. There is a huge spike in Asian hate crimes happening at the moment, and they have every right to talk about that. And not only were they discrediting the fact that they experience racism and this song was talking about that, they're also disregarding the fact that this song could be about gay rights and anti-homophobia, which was heavily implied through the use of rainbows, particularly near the start with a six-colored rainbow that was had a bi flag literally drawn over the top of it. But that is completely disregarded in this conversation that people are trying to have in this argument that is being brought up. It's the same people who were previously tweeting stop Asian hate, then turn around and decide to attack Asian men for speaking about racism that they experience. This type of fake activism is so harmful, and it stops non-Black people of color being able to speak about their experiences and the racism that they experience, even though everyone is included in this conversation. And especially when they're talking about racism that happens outside of America, a lot of this conversation gets immediately pulled to being about America and events and experiences of American people, which is obviously important. And obviously this song can still play a role in that, and people in the US can also relate to it, and it is important for literally everyone everywhere. It's just that a lot of the time these messages get pulled and twisted to cater to a US audience, even when that isn't the intention. Even if individually you don't see these things as issues, which I don't understand, how can you brush over the clear racial motivation? When you look at it overall, how K-pop is treated outside of Korea, it is very clear to see that there is a racial motive in this. And you can see that they are treated as less than human and are often referred to as manufactured. A really common thing you hear when talking about K-pop idols is that they are manufactured and that they are robots controlled by the industry. I just really want to know where this notion comes from and why everyone so casually dehumanizes and takes away their personhood. Becoming a K-pop idol, like most other careers, is a decision that they made. They go through a training program, which, yes, is quite intense, but no one is forcing them to be there. They can leave anytime they want to. They choose to stay there and pursue it and carry on until debut. And in this training program, the companies house them and feed them and give them an education. Like in Western industry, you don't go through a training process, but you're also definitely not provided housing or food or anything like that, which is continuously provided to K-pop idols throughout their career. Their living costs are covered by the company, and then they're paid in profit that they make, but they don't have to pay rent. They all live in dorms, which they can leave at any time they want to, but a lot of the time they choose to stay because they don't have to pay for it. As far as making it out of the training process and debuting as an idol, you obviously have to sign contracts which tell you what you can and can't do, as well as, you know, like giving you rules and things like that. And that varies from company to company. No one is going to have the same exact contract. But that's no different to the Western industry. All artists have to sign contracts that can often restrict what they can and can't do or say because it affects their image and therefore the company's image. You see people getting upset with management all the time in the Western media and for restricting what their artists are saying or doing. But the way that that is reflected when K-pop industries do the same thing is treated really, really differently, even though the two circumstances are practically exactly the same. A lot of people bring up the fact that in the K-pop industry, you are overworked, you are worked to death, and it is inhumane circumstances, which in general is not true overall. There used to be a really big problem with that, with what was called like a slave contract. However, for many, many years, those have been illegal. And a lot of people seem to disregard the fact that, or not even know that those slave contracts no longer exist. Those are no longer legal. There are regulations in place for how artists have to be treated. There is one clip in particular that is often used when people are talking about how K-pop idols are overworked, and that is a clip of BTS Jimin fainting after a performance that happened many years ago now. But this clip, Jimin fainting, has nothing to do with him being overworked. Jimin struggled with an eating disorder, and yes, this is obviously aided by being an artist and being in the spotlight and having people looking at you and judging you. But that isn't exclusive to K-pop. That exists literally everywhere. That is such a huge problem in all forms of media and just in day-to-day life. Eating disorders are a huge, huge issue, and you can't blame K-pop for causing that. You can blame, like, the media as being a really large part in that. And yes, there is a big problem with body image in Korea. But it's not exclusively in Korea. It's not exclusively in K-pop. And it is not a K-pop problem. And as I said earlier, a lot of people in the Western media, a lot of artists, they struggle with eating disorders and experience similar things. And you don't see people boycotting the entire music industry just because a few people have eating disorders. And if you see a real issue with Jimin fainting because of an eating disorder or anyone being impacted by eating disorders, which you should be doing something to aid that. You should be trying to raise awareness about eating disorders and breaking down those boundaries. Otherwise, you don't actually care. You are using it as an excuse to disregard an entire industry due to one particular event. Since this event took place, Jimin actively worked on healing and recovering and bettering himself. And he is in a much, much better place now than he was before. And a huge part of this was not only him helping himself, but also his group and his team helping him while also working to help other people with their entire concept of Love Yourself. This Love Yourself concept consisted of 3 albums, which were all about telling a story about a journey to self-acceptance and self-love. The aim of it was to encourage you to accept parts of your past that you may not like. It's about accepting everything you are and learning how to grow from that and love yourself through that, and regardless of what you have been through. Even all the scars from your mistakes make up the constellations. Other than the albums and the tours, they started a campaign called the Love Myself Campaign. And the Love Myself Campaign is a partnership with UNICEF that works to fight against violence and neglect while also encouraging you to love and accept yourself. They have been running this campaign since 2017 and have donated over $1 million and helped raise a further $3 million. They have not only actively worked on themselves and their own mental health, but they are actively working on trying to help other people learn how to love themselves and better themselves. And this is a decision that they made, not something that they were forced to do, not something they were told to do. They had the means to do something, so they did it. And they want to encourage other people to follow them. And that is why they have such a big and dedicated fan base, because they've run this campaign and through their music and them and everything they do, they encourage people to love themselves and accept themselves, and they pride themselves on that, and they want you to be the best version of yourself. And they actively work on that and say that and encourage that. So it's no wonder people are so connected to them. And I will talk about that a little bit more later. But I just think it's really good commentary on the fact that people just see clips on the internet and use them without looking any further than just seeing the clip and maybe hearing one or two sentences from a YouTuber or on a tweet or something like that. They don't have the information, yet they choose to continue to share something because it gets them clicks, it gets them views, whatever. Yes, there are obvious differences between the industry in the East and the industry in the West, but that is obviously going to happen. We're two different cultures. Western culture and Eastern culture are two different things, but that doesn't take away from the fact that we are all people and we all experience emotions and empathy and day-to-day life. We all experience different things in different ways, but we are all the same. As mentioned earlier, we are very English-centric, which also works for being very Western-centric. And this is very prevalent through the way we talk about K-pop and the way we show it and choose to depict it. As with only playing English songs on the radio, we also expect everyone to do what we do and act as we do because we do it best. And this is particularly prevalent through US and the US media, because we all know the US is very US-centric and it's really bad. And you see that a lot through people saying, wow, that sounds really American, as a compliment. Like, there's particular artists who get called like, oh, your music sounds very American, and that's like somehow the highest of praise. That's like the best thing you can do is to sound American, to sound like your music is Western, because Western music is better and that's the standard, which It shouldn't be. They're going to be different. They should be different. They're two different cultures. You shouldn't be trying to tell someone to change their culture and their style to fit your idea of what is culturally acceptable. Why are we so obsessed with everyone having to conform to how we live and following our ideologies and what we want? It feels very colonialist and wishing and expecting your influence and the influence of your culture and your country to take over and to convert everyone into your bubble of what you think is culturally appropriate and that conforms to your culture and yours alone, while also feeling threatened by the fact that the things that they're doing that are their culture is going to somehow hurt yours. The idea of having Korean culture in your country scares you and you don't want it. You only want it if they change it to be American. You'll accept Korean people if they sound American, if they look American, then that's fine. But as soon as they're actually Korean, you don't want them. And I don't know why people find it so threatening. They get really scared and really threatened. When like numbers are pulled out of K-pop, it's just instantly like, they don't deserve it. They don't deserve it. Why? Give me a reason. Why? Why don't they deserve it? Why are you so threatened? What's the matter? I agree that idols can be overworked, but you also have to understand that a lot of the time that is their own decision. They are choosing to commit to a lot of things. They are choosing to work as hard as they are because that's what they love, that's what they want to do. An example of this is the group called ATEEZ. ATEEZ are currently doing a competition show that I mentioned earlier where they have to do big budget, massive performance stages. And they also release an album at the same time. So they're practicing for this big stage performance while also performing for promotions for their album. And on top of this, a few of them are also in a TV drama, which is obviously a huge workload, but it is their job. And it is something that they chose to do and continue to choose to do. If they need a break, they can take one. Breaks are an acceptable thing to do. One of ATEEZ's members, Mingi, has been on break since November. His anxiety was getting really bad, and so he decided he needed some time off. He has stepped down from all activities and from the public eye to work on himself and to recover. He will make small appearances every now and then, such as his voice being in the album, but he didn't do promotions and he wasn't in the music video. And then occasionally he will post a photo of something just to let everyone know he's okay, or he'll do a phone call with someone on stage or on a live stream.
여보세요?
여보세요?
네, 여보세요?
To remind everyone that he's still there, but he needed a break. And that was okay. A lot of companies understand that their artists are important. Their mental health is important. It is capitalism. A lot of the time, you know, they're not gonna make you money if they're doing badly, right? So you have to treat them as people. Companies that exploit their workers and overwork them often fail because people don't want to be there. The public call them out. The public don't like that they treat them like that. It's a big deal. You don't like when it happens. Why do you think that the Korean public is going to accept it? They don't. A lot of the time, those companies that exploit their workers fail. A lot of the bigger companies or the ones who are successful right now take good care of their artists. They're are many instances outside of Mingi taking a mental health break where artists take breaks for their mental health. Another example is one of the biggest companies, JYP. Recently, a couple of their members have had breaks for mental health, with both Mina and Jungyeon from Twice taking mental health breaks recently and coming back slowly when they're ready to. And then there's other instances such as Han from Stray Kids, who has stepped out of fan signs and places where there's lots of people because he suffers from social anxiety and they are aware of that, and his health is a priority. They don't want their artists to be unwell or sick in any way, and that includes mental health. JYP even provide their artists with therapists should they need them. Although obviously mental health and all these issues aren't always taken seriously, and there are instances where people are neglected and they do suffer and they are failed and aren't given help when they're required. I am definitely not trying to say that it's a perfect industry and that everyone is taken care of. It definitely isn't. There's definitely still a lot of awful things that happen in the industry. The point is that it's no different to the Western industry in that regard. Awful things happen in the Western industry too. So many people's mental health isn't taken care of. We have lost so many people in all forms of media, everywhere, not just in music, but so many awful things happen to artists and it is called out, but the industry itself isn't boycotted for those reasons. So why is the K-pop industry boycotted for those reasons? The hypocrisy is just really blatant to the point where obviously there are issues within all industries, no matter where you're from. But the K-pop industry is boycotted and evil and bad and it's full of fake people who are all manufactured and controlled, and I can't support that industry. I can't support those people because of that. Whereas the Western industry, who also has issues of people being exploited and taken advantage of and struggling with mental health and abuse, etc., why is that then okay to support if this isn't? As far as idols not being seen as people for whatever reason, I find this one so strange because idols are typically some of the most genuine people you will find within the music industry, which is why fans are so attached to them and why there's so much love and dedication and why there is so quick to defend them and why there is so much emotion there. There's an endless stream of content from their own shows on YouTube or on TV to live streams where they just sit down and they just talk or they sing or they dance and they answer questions and interact with you, to apps where they message you and you can message back, to behind the scenes videos that they provide. There is so much and it is a constant flow of it. And there is such a deep connection between the artist and the audience because of all this content that they get, because you do see more into their lives. You do see them as people and how they live. And that's why people feel so attached and so connected to them. And you don't get that much within other industries and within the Western industry. There is nowhere near as much content. There's nowhere near as much fan interaction and nowhere near as much like seeing into their actual lives as you get with K-pop. There are also other examples of them just existing and being real people outside of this extra content that they do, such as Jay from Day 6. He's a Twitch streamer and he did a stream with Corpse and AOC and Maya MXMToon, which is really cool. And then there's also people who will go onto Instagram Live completely off their face drunk.
I'm not drunk yet.
And just mess around with filters because why not? Because they're people and they can do that because they're people and they want to share their lives with their fans, with the people that got them to where they are, with the people that they appreciate. There's also Bang Chan from Stray Kids, who every Sunday does a live stream called Chan's Room, where he sits down and he plays music and he answers questions and he gives advice for an hour a week. And no one is making him do that. No one tells him to do it. He doesn't get paid. He does that because he wants to. And if ever he misses one, he always profusely apologizes and tries to make up for it. No one is making anyone do any of those things. This isn't for any gain. They don't gain anything from this. They don't have to go live. They don't have to Twitch stream. They don't have to give all of this extra content. They don't have to do that. Literally no one is making them. That is the decision that they make on their own. Not only all of this, but most artists also participate in the writing of their own songs, with some groups even being completely self-written and self-produced. Stray Kids, once again, is an example of this, with their group having three members who are also writers and producers. And the three of them, Han, Bang Chan, and Chungbin, will write 100% of the lyrics by themselves with no co-writers, and then produce 95% of their songs as well, with Bang Chan being involved on all of those tracks, and sometimes they are also the only people to produce said tracks with no help from anyone in the entire creation of the song, which is very, very rare in anywhere in the world. Is very rare for people to write and produce their own music. BTS, ATEEZ, G-IDLE, Seventeen, and Purple Kiss are also examples of groups that self-write and self-produce a majority of their music. Some companies also offer training in production. If that is something that you as an artist wish to learn to do, that is an option available to you. If you want to learn how to produce, cool, you can do that. You can pursue your interests and you will be supported in pursuing said interests. There is a lot of liberty there. And although obviously not all groups do this, not all groups are self-written or self-produced, it is far more common than most people believe. A lot of people like to paint K-pop in the way that it is very fake and everything is done for them and they are controlled, but they have so much more liberty than so many other artists do outside of K-pop, outside of Korea. So why is that still there? Why are we choosing to ignore the fact that all these artists are so independent and creating such real and meaningful music that they have done themselves, that comes from their heart and somewhere and something that they care about, but it's overlooked and deemed as fake because people don't want to actually look into it or read the lyrics or put any thought into it. I would also like to point out that this includes people within the K-pop conversation. It includes people who are in the community and who identify as K-pop stans. With so many fans taking away personhood of idols and artists that they dislike or even artists that they like, a lot of people take it upon themselves to baby idols and feel the need to protect them and say like, oh, your company is failing you. We'll go out of our way to like find you lawyers and to sort this out because your company isn't doing anything. But they don't do that when this shit happens to Western artists. I've never seen anyone say, oh, Lady Gaga's in trouble. I will sort it out. I will get her a lawyer. People just assume that they know better than idols, that they know better in this industry, but they would never do it for the industry in their own country. And I don't think people think about that, but that is infantilizing. That is racist in terms of the fact you're saying that they don't understand how anything works and you know better, you as a fan know better than like the lawyers that their company has. No, you don't need to do that. That is not your job. Your job as a fan is to be a fan. It's to support them. It's to listen to their music and it is to stream their content. It is to support them and love them, but it is not your place to protect them. That's not your job. And implying that you know what's best for them when you don't know them is just not true. I don't mean to discredit any of the bad things that happen within the industry. A lot of people suffer due to it, and that is obviously a very big issue. It's just important to note that these same issues are brushed over and looked past in the Western media, however they are amplified within K-pop. They are much more rare than they are portrayed to be, with so many people believing that this is the entire industry when in fact it is a very small part of it. You can support K-pop and K-pop artists without supporting companies that exploit the artists. They are easily avoidable, and if you don't want to contribute to that, which you definitely should not want to contribute to, then avoid those companies. Do your research when you're going into supporting a group and where you're putting your money. It's just very interesting how we're so quick to jump on the K-pop industry and call everyone within it fake and manufactured. The fact that this is explicitly reserved for the K-pop industry demonstrates that there are racial undertones to this statement. Asian people are often dehumanized and infantilized, as in having their personhood taken away and having people be like, I know better than you, I will protect you, not like, oh my god, he's so cute, that's fine. And they're also fetishized by so many people, including K-pop stans. If you're upset by the numbers that they, particularly BTS, get in terms of streaming and music videos and sales, etc., then you just have to work harder for the artists that you enjoy. It is within the listener's control to how well the artist succeeds. Army are organized. They love those men so much, and they are dedicated because they want what is best for them. They want to show them how much they love them and how much they care about them. They want to say thank you, and they do that through getting them awards, through getting them streams, through showing them that they are the best because they truly believe they are the best. And they do this through things such as hosting streaming parties where they will get together and watch videos together or stream songs together. They will do music video streaming competitions where they'll create playlists for different regions of the world, and you go and watch your region's playlist, and whichever playlist gets the most streams, that region wins. They are so creative and so organized and come up with so many ideas in order to get these numbers and help the people they love achieve those results. And it is possible for anyone to do. But the thing is that people aren't that dedicated to the artists that they love. And that is not BTS's fault. That's not ARMY's fault. That isn't K-pop's fault. That is within you as a fan, your control. You don't have to like K-pop. You don't have to like the industry. You just have to accept that they're people. That we're all people. We have different interests, and what others enjoy doesn't affect you. It doesn't concern you. Idols are just as deserving of radio play and awards and airtime as anyone else. They deserve the same basic treatment as everyone else gets, even at the low standard that the creative industries worldwide have. They need to be improved everywhere. The creative industries are shocking, and they need real improvement everywhere. Leave people to enjoy what they want to enjoy, and if you don't like it, ignore it, block it, mute it, whatever. It's got nothing to do with you. Going out of your way to piss people off doesn't do anything. It doesn't do anyone any good. It's a waste of your time. So now we have reached the portion of the video where I'm going to give a little bit of a story time. And that is that Kat has been a fan of K-pop, particularly BTS, for many, many years now. And I know that it makes her happy. And when we first moved in together, it was coming up to award season. And so to support her and be the lovely best friend that I am, I offered to watch the Mamas with her. And that is when my entire life changed. That is when Stray Kids came out on stage dressed like this, and they did this. And I needed to know more. I craved it. I needed to know more. And that is when Kat and I nosedived so fast, so deep. They consumed our entire lives. It was the only music I listened to for months. They put out so much content that we were able to fill up so much time with just watching them and spending time with them and getting to know them, which is so comforting. It is so lovely having a connection with someone. I have been involved in stan culture before as a teenager. It was something that really, really helped me as a person and helped me through hard times. And receiving this now and getting back into a place where I have that comfort again has been really helpful and really good for my mental health over the past few months of lockdown, where it was really, really hard. And with Stray Kids and with K-pop in general, like I said, there is so much content and they have so much love and they put so much out there that it really just does make you feel loved and appreciated and like you're a part of something bigger. Since getting into Stray Kids, after a few months, Kat introduced me to more K-pop, and it is now a majority of what I listen to. And through watching Kingdom, which is the competition show, we extended our love out to the rest of the Zed line, which is the boys and ATEEZ, whom we love very, very much, although Stray Kids will obviously always have the biggest part of our hearts. And that brings me to my next question. If anyone knows where to find this Chanhee photo card of him as a little prince, please let me know. We are willing to sell our souls for it. We'll literally do anything. Comment, DM me on Instagram, tweet me, fucking email me. I don't care. We need it. If you know where it is, I will give you my soul. If you have one, if you know, please. Ultimately, I never expected to get into K-pop. I absolutely did not ever expect to get to the place where I am with how much love and joy I have for this and for all the people I've met through it. And it makes me feel so loved and so comforted because I can feel their love. And as I said, that is why they are so popular. And I do understand it. Once you get into K-pop, you get into K-pop because it is so warm and comforting. They show us more love than anyone. It's something that you might benefit from. It's something that might help you with your confidence or with how you're feeling and your mental health in whatever way. And you won't ever know if you keep sticking to the narrative that is being fed to you by the media or by other people, whether that's from misogyny or racism or whatever. Question why you have a distaste for it and why you dislike it. And maybe you will find that it is something that you can find joy in and it is something that you can find confidence, such as myself. I'm not saying you have to like K-pop. I'm not saying you even have to give it a chance. Just let people enjoy things. Just let people enjoy things to whatever degree they wish to. Because if it makes them happy, then it makes them happy and it doesn't have anything to do with you. I hope that you have learned how your actions may be racist or misogynistic, whether intentional or not. And I hope that you realize their humanity, which unfortunately has to be pointed out. To finish this off, I would like to read a statement from Namjoon of BTS from their recent Rolling Stones interview. Now, of course, there's no utopia. There's a light side and there's always going to be a dark side. The way we think is that everything that we do and our existence itself is contributing to the hope for leaving the xenophobia. These negative things behind, it's our hope too. That people in the minority will draw some energy and strength from our existence. Yes, there's xenophobia, but there are also a lot of people who are very accepting. The fact that we have faced success in the United States is very meaningful in and of itself. A big thank you to my KiwiFruit and KiwiBao channel members whose names are up on the screen right now. And a massive thank you to my channel member of the day, Ellie. I love and appreciate you so, so much. Thank you so much for joining. If you would like to become a channel member, you can click the top link in the description or the little blue join button. You get my videos a day early, as well as 10% off my shop when I have things on my shop. And as a KiwiBao member, you get some extra videos that don't make it into the main video. So I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope that you've learned something. I know that it was very, very long. So thank you for sticking around if you are still here. Don't forget to stream Stray Kids Kingdom Stage and vote on who's fan. I hope that you enjoy the rest of your day. Stay safe. Keep fighting. I love you.
안녕.